a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire, standing next to me. There was another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another. Oh, my dad left for dead beneath the water. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I find in the space between what remains of me?
grace is found is where you are, and where you
today to be a part of this joyous day. Happy Easter. Thank you for coming today.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, reply.
disappointment, your Sunday's empty tomb. Since when has impossible ever stopped you?
This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Pentecostal fire, stirring something new.
Take a moment to greet those around you. There's a lot of people here this morning. My name's Sarah Hawthorne, and I'm the family pastor here at Town and Field Church. One of the special things that I get to be a part of this morning is the fact that the kids are in the service. So if you're a kid in the service, show me your hands. Yes, up on the balcony. I feel like you guys never get a shout out. Hi, balcony. Our kids on the way in, you guys, I don't know if you guys grabbed an envelope, but there's resources for you today for the service. Pastor Dave is going to give us a great message today. So if you didn't get one of these colorful envelopes or one of these little Easter booklets, they're in the lobby there. You can grab one. I know Courtney's standing out there this morning. One of the things we love to do here at Town and Field Church is we're a giving people. So I would invite you, whether that is through prayer or financially, we want to just walk with you in building God's kingdom. And one of the ways to do that is financially. And you can give at Town and Field Church. We've got offering boxes. You can give online. And I just invite you to do that with me today. We have Pastor Dave coming up to give us a message. But before I invite him up, I have two special friends who are going to come up here and pray for this morning and pray for Pastor Dave, Liv and Avery and their mom. Come on up, girls.
And dear Jesus, thank you for this day, and thank you for Jesus dying on the cross, and please, and thank you for giving away our sins, and thank you that we have a great time together. And Lord, please bless Pastor Dave as he brings us these blessings and messages this morning. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
That was awesome. Thank you, Sarah, for organizing my life for me. Oh, I could join the worship team, except I have no rhythm. That would be a mistake. It is great to be together. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. So what's the big deal about Easter? There's two major events on the Christian calendar that we celebrate and are celebrated worldwide. One is Christmas, and the other is Easter. Christmas, we celebrate for weeks. You go to the mall 6 weeks before Christmas, and there's Christmas music playing. You go everywhere. People are decorating their homes, and weeks ahead of Christmas, the celebration goes on. Easter, not quite the same. I don't know, maybe the birth of a baby is more palatable than some guy hanging on a cross. Maybe there's something that's a little more romantic or exciting about giving gifts and receiving gifts than there is about thinking about sacrifice. But Easter is still a big deal. Resurrections aren't as common as births, and so that could be another reason. So what is the big deal? Well, new clothes. Do you like my sweater? My wife bought this for me, special for Easter. It makes me look like an Easter egg. I'm the same shape even. And then my valet, a.k.a. Wendy, as she was suggesting how I might dress this morning, she thought a shirt and tie would be appropriate. You might never see this again unless it's at your funeral. And then you won't see it either. But I'm wearing it today, and I'm happy that she bought me a nice Easterish looking sweater. How many of you are wearing something new today? There's a few of you. It used to be a big deal, right, when I was growing up, Easter Sunday. And I think part of it was, you know, changing seasons. It's like put away the winter clothes and buy something new for spring, and everybody wore it on Easter Sunday. New beginnings, a chance to start over. Spring is here. I love spring. I have enjoyed my morning walk so much, seeing the little daffodils starting to bloom and the trees blossom. And those of you who have allergies are not enjoying it so much. But for those of us who don't, it's awesome. It's a beautiful time of year. All these new beginnings, the changing of seasons, which remind us of the fact that God is faithful. And then if you're a little traditional, spring is also the time you sort of clean the cobwebs out of your house, right? Spring cleaning, you freshen everything up and make everything new. It's a good reminder to make all things new in life as well. And then there is the new life that comes with the trees budding. One of the things I enjoy in my walk, there's a little duck pond not far from where we live. And as spring is approaching, you see all these ducks pairing up. Soon there'll be all the baby ducks. It's a new life, right? It's exciting. Spring is beautiful. Easter is beautiful. And, of course, there's the eggs and rabbits, which we can sort of try to justify them, right? Because they remind us of new life, and so we eat chocolate. And speaking of chocolate, chocolate is part of Easter. And you know what? If you're here this morning and you are normally part of Kids Town during this time, we're going to ask you to stand up, and we're going to bring you chocolate. Anybody who's 10 or 12 and under, stand up. We've got chocolate for you this morning. When was the last time you got chocolate halfway through a sermon? It's been a while. If you're 10 or under right now, or 12 and under, Kids Town kids, or if you're visiting and you're that age, Rich Peachy, you are not 10 and under. Sorry. But I think you have grandkids, and they might share their chocolates with you. Keep handing out the chocolates. It's awesome. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Gladness fills the words today. From the tomb that could not hold him, see, the stone is rolled away. That's why we celebrate. It's not over. If you were here on Good Friday, in the evening we had an incredible service as we focused on the cross. And we invited people to make a journey to the cross. And you'll see that there's a pile of rocks in front of this cross. The rocks aren't just here to look pretty and make the stage look beautiful. These rocks were along the path on Friday evening. And we encouraged people to pick up a rock to represent their sin, maybe sin that someone had committed against them, to represent the burdens they were carrying, to represent the fears in their lives, to represent people that didn't know Christ. And we invited them to bring these things and leave them at the cross. Because it was at the cross that Christ paid the price for all of that. It was at the cross that the price for sin was paid. It's at the because of the cross that we can be forgiven. And we'll talk about that a little bit in a minute. But it's not over. It's not over. The cross was Friday. The resurrection was Sunday. And whatever you brought to the cross or whatever you're bringing to the cross, the last chapter is not yet written. I remember a number of years ago, Wendy and I were invited to someone's home. It was somebody who was a leader in our church, somebody who had been very involved, good friends of ours. And they confessed that there had been some marital unfaithfulness in their marriage. And the man was devastated. He was weeping and repentant. And I remember Wendy looking across the room at him and saying, "The last chapter is not written." When God looks at your life, he sees pure gold. Because that's the finished product. That's what we look forward to. And so we want to think for a moment about the Easter story once again. It was early Sunday morning. A group of frightened and doubting women huddled together as they hurried to the place of burial. I'm not sure, but on their way out of the city, they may have had to pass that wretched place known as Golgotha, the place of the skull, the place where executions took place. It was a horrible place. Crucifixion was the worst kind of execution possible. And they passed by that hill, perhaps, and saw the place where their friend Jesus had died. This place was all the more despicable because of the fact that Christ had been there. All of their hopes were hanging on that cross on Execution Hill. But now as they passed by, all they saw was the empty cross, silhouetted against the sky that was just turning color from the rising sun. It wasn't a bad dream after all. He had died. He didn't deserve to die. He had never done anything to deserve what he went through. They tried to shake that painful memory as they hurried on. That was Friday, but this was Sunday. And this was a day to show their love for the one who had died. They had prepared the spices. They had prepared the embalming ointments. And they were going now to do what they weren't able to do as the sun had set and Sabbath began. He had been laid in a tomb, but they couldn't lovingly take care of their friend. And now they were going back to do just that. There hadn't been time to bury him properly, but now they wanted to show their love. But how would they roll that huge stone away that had been placed over the tomb and sealed by Rome? As they were wrestling with these doubts and fears, it seemed that the earth beneath them began to move. What was that? They didn't have time to worry about it because they were trying to get to Jesus. They had bigger concerns, more important work to do. And as they neared the grave, the sight they saw caused them even greater confusion. The stone was already rolled away. The Roman guards that had been given the job of making sure no one would steal the body were nowhere in sight. And they hurried towards the empty tomb. And as they were looking inside, two men dressed in bright clothes that seemed to reflect the morning light looked at them and said, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen just as he said. Go and tell his disciples." And so they hurried back to the city where the disciples were hiding in fear and trepidation. Most of them didn't know what to do, but John and Peter jumped up and ran to look for themselves. Peter entered the grave, and he saw something he could hardly believe. In the very spot where they had laid the body of Jesus, all that was left was empty grave clothes. The linen that they had wrapped his body in was there, but no body. And off to the side, folded neatly, was the cloth that they had wrapped around his wounded head. They saw and they believed. The empty cross, the place where the innocent Son of God had died for the sin of all mankind. The empty tomb, evidence of the fact that Jesus rose to conquer sin and death and hell. And they recalled and rejoiced in the promise of eternal life. The empty grave clothes, he didn't just rise spiritually. He rose physically. His body was gone. It was a body that they could touch and embrace and share a meal with. He rose and he lives today, and he desires each one of us to have a personal relationship with him. This is what gives us hope. The fact of the resurrection is what we hinge our entire Christian faith on. It is one of the most defendable facts of history, but it's also one of the most challenged facts of history. So about 20 years after the fact, the Apostle Paul wrote a letter to the church in Corinth in which he defends his belief in the resurrection. And he encourages these new Christians as they're experiencing persecution for their faith. I invite you to take your Bibles right now or your phone, wherever you have the scripture, and follow along as I read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting at verse 12. "But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But if he did not raise him, in fact, the dead are not raised. And if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep." There's basically two issues that Paul addresses in this passage. One is this: if Christ had not risen from the dead, then what? Well, there's a few things. If Christ had not risen from the dead, then Christ would be no more than a liar or a lunatic. He declared himself to be the Son of God. He said, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will bring it back." He said, "I'm going to die, but I'm going to rise again." And he kept teaching and talking about the fact that he was God in human form and that he was going to rise again. And if there was no resurrection from the dead, then Christ himself would be a liar or a lunatic. At the graveside of his friend Lazarus, he declared, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even if he dies, shall live." If there was no resurrection, Christ would have been a great deceiver. If Christ had not been risen from the dead, the disciples were completely deceived. This was the key to their joyful testimony. This is what changed everything. After the death of Jesus, they went into hiding for fear that they too would be arrested because they had been followers of this one who had died. But after the resurrection and the promise of the Holy Spirit that Jesus said would come once he was resurrected from the dead, once he had ascended to them, they became bold. They became the strongest force on earth. They were transformed. They became courageous and joyful. The difference was they had seen the empty tomb. They had encountered the risen Lord and received his promise. If Christ is not alive, the Christian church is a gigantic fraud. Without the resurrection, the church would be a great structure with no foundation, and it would eventually crumble. I thought it was interesting. As I did a little bit of research, we have about 8 billion people in the world right now. 2.6 billion of those people profess to be Christians in almost every nation of the world. The church stands triumphant. Now, of those 2.6 billion, which is about 31% of the world's population, about half of them are Catholics. The other half are Protestants or evangelicals. Among that, there's about 600 million people that are evangelicals. And the definition of someone who's evangelical is someone who holds to the authority of the Word of God and believes that salvation is through the death and resurrection of Christ and that we're called on a mission to join in sharing the good news. But the church has continued to thrive, and the number of evangelicals in the world continues to grow. The number of those who believe that the resurrection and death and resurrection of Christ is what makes a difference. The church continues to be strong. There are some struggles, which we'll talk about in a minute, but the church is doing okay. It has survived nearly 2,000 or over 2,000 years. If Christ had not been risen from the dead, the Christian experience would be a delusion. You'd have no assurance of forgiveness. You couldn't claim the right to have a relationship with God and have joy from that. The peace that you claim to experience in all circumstances would be just a figment of your imagination. The fellowship we claim to have with God and our hope for the world to come would all be nothing but a lie. And the millions throughout history from every nation who have experienced the same reality would be deluded and betrayed. If Jesus was not risen from the dead, there would be no life after death. Instead of departing to be with Christ, we would die like a dog, and there would be no future. There'd be nothing after death. The joy and peace of a dying Christian is nothing more, would be nothing more than an illusion. I have sat at the bedside of many people as they're leaving this world and going into eternity. And when you're sitting beside someone who knows Jesus, there's a peace. There's a reality that can't be explained. But it would all be a false reality if Christ had not. It would be a fantasy. Everything we pin our hopes on would be a hallucination. And Paul goes on and declares, if Christ had not been risen from the dead, of all people, we should be pitied more than anyone else. Instead of living life on a high pinnacle of blessing, we would be relegated to a pit of darkness and despair. If Christ were not alive, the Christian life would be a ghostly mirage. Our faith would be in vain. We would still be in our sin, and we would have no hope. But, Paul declares, Christ has risen from the dead. As we began to prepare for this service, I asked the staff team, I said, if we were to talk about the difference that the resurrection makes in a life, is there someone that you can think of that would be good to talk to in the service? And without a doubt, everyone said Paula would be the person. Paula, why don't you come and join me for just a minute? Well, I've tried to figure out how to pronounce your last name, and I'm not getting it right. So can you help me with that?
Koretko.
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 Okay,
yes.
Koretko. I can handle it.
Ukrainian.
There's a
Thank
chair
you.
For you. You can sit on that so you can relax a little bit while I talk to you for a minute. Sure. So, Paula, how long have you been coming to Town and Field Church?
I've been coming for 5 years now.
For 5 years?
Yes.
And I can tell, you know, when Paula came into my office to talk about this, I had no idea who to expect or what to expect. And this lovely lady walked into my office with this glow on her face. And I thought, wow, there's something special. But that glow wasn't always there, was it?
No, it wasn't, Dave.
Tell me a little bit about your life before you met Jesus.
My life, my story is a story of resurrection, transformation. But my life was a story of addiction. This is a family service, so I'm going to keep it clean.
It'll be PG.
PG rated. But about 38 years of my life was addiction. Drugs, alcohol, and everything that goes along with that. And about the last, about 8 years ago, I was on very harsh and hard drugs. And I came near the end of my life. I couldn't bear life anymore as it was. And I knew I couldn't take my life because I did always believe in God, but I was desperate. And I knew that something had to give. So one day I got down on my knees and I just said, Lord, I can't take this anymore. And I can't take my life, so what am I going to do? And his voice literally came to me and said, you're not going to die. I'm going to save you. But you're going to die to yourself. This life is over. You will not be that person anymore. You will not do these things. Your life will change forever. And I said, I'm ready.
What did you do? Did somebody come and preach to you, or what happened?
No, I opened up the Bible. He just was speaking to me, literally, in my head. I heard voices. And I opened up the Bible to the book of Psalms, because it was my mom's favorite book. I didn't want to start at the beginning. And the very first verse in the book of Psalms is, blessed are those who do not stand and walk with the wicked. So I knew then, Dave, that my life had to change. I could not be blessed and I could not carry on like this anymore.
And so you began to surrender all of that to Christ. You said you felt you needed to die.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for the transformation to take place, you actually did have to die.
I really did. I had to give up my life as I knew it. Yeah, I died to myself.
And what happened in exchange?
In exchange, within 5 months, it's just such a miracle. Within 5 months, the Lord took away every single addiction I had, and I'm talking a lot of them. Everything you can imagine, I was addicted to.
Amen.
Yeah. So, 5 months, yeah.
And then you ended up coming here. What brought you here?
Yeah, he was speaking to me. I had to rest for a couple of years after I quit everything just to adjust to a new life. He moved me out of the city here into a beautiful place. And then I could hear the Holy Spirit saying, Paula, it's time that you find your new community, your new home, your new friends, your new life. So I called my Aunt Audrey in the States, and I said, Audrey, what church should I go to? And she said, well, your mother and I believed in the Evangelical Free Church. Why don't you start there? So I looked it up, and I came here one Sunday and walked in the door, and Don Reddick was at the door. And he said, oh, I don't think I've ever seen you here before. Are you new and by yourself? I said, yes, I am. And he said, well, aren't you a brave woman? And I thought, boy, did I need to hear that, because I really did feel like I was being brave. And he said, well, I hope you like it here and you stay. And I said, okay. And he showed me to a seat, and here I am 5 years later.
Amen.
Yeah.
And Paula, what has the Lord given you as a result of that surrender?
Well, the Lord has given me, I never had children, in my life, but I've had lots of nieces and nephews and great nieces and nephews, and I'm telling you, this church has given me more kids than I could ever imagine. The babysitting I do and the kids' town, and it's just, it brings such joy to me, and a community that is just unbelievable. Yeah.
So the challenges aren't over. You're still dealing with some stuff in your life. What's going on now?
Oh, yeah. And I just want to say struggles, don't look at struggles in your life and challenges as a bad thing. They're a part of your life, and God will do something out of them. Down the road, you'll realize, wow, I went through that because of this or because of that. And when you have faith in the Lord, you don't have to fear anything. You don't have to search for your identity. You know who you are and where you're going. I'm here to serve God, and I'm going to the kingdom of heaven. I don't fear death. I don't fear anything anymore. You're
going with going through a particular challenge right
yes,
now.
Yes, yeah. Right now. I've been dealing with, I got diagnosed with a blood cancer 3 years ago, and usually medication can keep that at bay. So I started on the first medication, and it didn't work. I wasn't responding, so they put me on the second one, and I didn't respond to that. And then this past third year, they put me on the third and final medication, and I really wasn't responding to that either. And I thought, no, come on, Lord, this isn't happening. And they said, you may need a bone marrow transplant. And I thought, no, I'm not going there. And I just had all my friends and community praying for me. And I said, let's give it 3 more months on this medication because I don't want that transplant. And just last week, my doctor, I had an appointment, and she said, Paula, for the first time in 3 years, you're responding to the medication. So you don't need a transplant.
That's awesome. Yeah. So Paula, this is a question, and I want you to just sort of sum up with this. The fact that Jesus Christ is alive, the fact that he rose from the dead, what difference does that make as you have faced the challenges of life?
Oh, Dave, it's such a reassuring thing. Like I said earlier, I don't fear. I don't fear death because we don't die. And Jesus died for us. So I know that my life is going to be eternity in the kingdom of heaven. I don't fear my identity. I know where I'm going. He just keeps, you have to keep strong in your faith and remind yourself every day that that whatever you're going through, he's with you. He's already shown us that he's done this miracle. He's already died and risen for us. So it doesn't matter what goes on in this life. You keep him close, keep your eye toward the Lord, and stay in his word, and live your life serving him.
So you had to die to mm-hmm. self.
Had to die to myself.
But now you're alive.
And now I'm alive, absolutely.
I'm crucified with Christ.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me.
Yeah, my life died at that time, and I rose again, and he gave me a brand new life. Mm-hmm.
And if there's somebody here who came to church today because it's Easter, and maybe they're not experiencing what you are, what would you say to them?
I would just say, don't give up hope, and don't let yourself feel you're not worthy or that it's impossible. Nothing is impossible, and I think you have to really, really focus on God and his word. You have to do that. And it can come and go in waves. Sometimes we're more dedicated than other times. But don't let your struggles and your troubles make you who you are. They're just part of your life. And look at them that way.
They don't define you.
Don't look at them that this is it.
Your definition of life is in your relationship with Jesus.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Thanks, Paula.
You're welcome, Dave. Appreciate you sharing with us.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody.
Paul says, if Christ had not been risen from the dead, then what? But he also says, because Christ is risen, so what? The resurrection is one of the best attested facts in history. We don't have time to look at all the evidence, but there are a few things that Paul says because Christ is risen. One is, it makes sense to share the good news. Because there's a lot of Paulas out there in the world that are struggling without hope. We talked about the fact that over 2 billion people in the world profess to be Christians. 500 million of those would understand what that means in the same way that we do through faith in Christ. But that means there's still a lot of people that need to hear the gospel. There are over 2 billion people in the world that have never heard the gospel in a way that they can make a choice to respond. But because Jesus is alive, it makes sense to share the gospel. We're called to demonstrate the love of God by being passionate about the things Jesus was passionate about. Jesus said, I came to set prisoners free. I came to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to give hope to people. And we need to be people of hope. We need to be living out that hope in such a way that people might ask the reason, why do you have this hope? What's different about you? What is it that causes Paula's face to glow? What is it that causes your face to glow? What is it that impacts the people where you work and where you go to school? Do they see Jesus in you? Because Jesus is alive, it makes sense to share the good news of the gospel in word and in deed. And he says, I will be with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And by the power of my spirit in you, you will be part of seeing lives changed and hope spread. Because Jesus is alive, our faith is built on a solid foundation. We're not serving a dead Savior. I have good friends in our building that are of different faiths, different religions. Last night, Wendy and I were invited. Something came up and we weren't able to go, but we were invited to go and join some of our friends as they're breaking the fast of Ramadan for the day, and they had quite a celebration. And they're all there, and they're sort of pinning their hope on what they believe is true. But when we talk about it with them and talk about the promise of eternal life, they just don't have that same foundation that we have because Jesus is alive. Our faith is built on a solid foundation. And because Jesus rose from the grave, our sins are forgiven. Paula, you lived a rough life, but you're never going to have to pay for any of that sin, are you? It's been paid in full. We were having a little conversation before the Good Friday service, and Kara made a comment that really struck me. She said, you know, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And she said, you know, I was thinking about that. The fact that the penalty of sin will be separation from God and everything that's good forever. And in those moments on the cross, Jesus was separated from God and everything that was good, and all of evil was poured upon him, all the price of my sin and your sin. And because of that, because he paid the price, our sins can be forgiven. There is no sin so great that his love is not greater. God accepted the price his son paid for our redemption. And if we accept his free gift, he will never remember our sins against us. And because Jesus is alive, our hope goes beyond the grave. We can know the love and peace and power of God as we face the challenges of life. I don't know what issues you're dealing with today, but friend, it's not over. You're in a process. You're becoming more and more like Jesus as he works in your life. And one day you will see him, you'll be with him, and you'll be like him. But until then, we're in this process, and by his grace, he brings things into our lives to transform us more and more into the image of his son. The pure gold only comes as the refiner's fire works in our lives, and sometimes that's tough. Sometimes there's challenges. Sometimes it's painful. But in all of that, God is present. And we can have hope in this life and beyond the grave. I want to read just a few more verses out of 1 Corinthians 15, starting at verse 50. I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed, for the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Because Jesus has risen from the dead, we can experience peace and victory in every circumstance. The sting of death is not in death itself. The sting of death is in the judgment we will face after death if we have not had our sins forgiven. But we can experience peace and victory in every circumstance because the ultimate enemy has been put to death. And if death has been swallowed up in victory, that victory can be ours as we face the most difficult challenges of life. Because he lives, I too shall live. And because he lives, I can face the challenges of every day. And because Jesus is alive, instead of being pitied more than anyone, Christians should be envied above everyone else in the world. No matter how challenging or difficult life becomes, we have the assurance that the power of Christ living in us can be a reality. I'm going to read verses 57 and 58 of the message, or out of 1 Corinthians, out of the message. I just love the way Peterson sort of expands it a little bit. He says, but now in a single victorious stroke of life, all three, sin, guilt, death are gone, the gift of our Master Jesus Christ. Thank God. With all of this going for us, my dear friends, stand your ground and don't hold back. Throw yourself into the work of the Master, confident that nothing you do for him is a waste of time or effort. It's not over. Easter, the hope for now and for eternity. I'm going to invite the music team to come back to the stage, and as they're coming, I just want to get a little bit practical and maybe say something that some of you need to hear this morning. Paula just shared her testimony of the fact that she shares in the death and resurrection of Christ. She died with Christ. She's risen with Christ. There's two ordinances that the church shares in. One is the Lord's Supper, where we remember his death. And the other is baptism, where we make a public declaration of our identification with Christ in his death and resurrection. Baptism is symbolic of that reality. There are some of you here, last Easter, I understand you had a baptism. We're not having one this Easter. But this Easter could be the Sunday when two things might happen. For some of you, you might say, I need to die to self and receive Christ in his life. You can do that very simply by faith. Just right where you're sitting, this worship team sings, just say, Lord Jesus, I give it all up to you. Lord Jesus, I give you my life. That's the starting point. There might be a lot of conversations you have to have about that. But you can start by surrendering your life to Jesus today. And if you're here and you claim to be a follower of Jesus, but you have never declared that publicly through baptism, it's something that Jesus commands us to do. You may want to consider it. Talk to one of the elders, talk to myself, send me an email. We'd love to help you do that. But now as we close the service, we want to stand together and celebrate again the life that is ours because of Jesus.
Songs. You want to come up and sing? You can come up in front of the stage and sing with us. There's songs you know. And if you're afraid, you can bring a mom or a dad.
Come on, kids. Let's
go. Someone else. Come on, kids. Up front. You know this one.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah. Thank you.
that you know.
Much for being here with us today. I'm going to invite my friend Maggie up here to help me close the service. Yeah. What a wonderful Sunday morning. Do you guys agree? Let's give a big round of applause for this beautiful morning together. Let us be a people that boldly shares the gospel together. We are so glad you're here with us. There are some special treats in the lobby, so stick around, be in community together. And I have my friend Maggie here who's going to share a very special announcement.
We have an exciting Kidstown Camp announcement. Our theme this year is scuba diving into friendship with God. Next week, registration opens for campers and volunteers, and we can't wait to share more about it with you.
Awesome. So make sure you're here next week so we can do all things camp. Thank you, guys. Have a wonderful day.